The typical way a convolutional neural network is constructed is by having a number of convolutional layers in the beginning, and then after each one of them, or at least after a few convolutional layers, we have a pooling layer. And then it continues in the same way, convolutional layers followed by pooling layers, and then in the end we have a few fully connected layers that then feed to the output layer that has an activation function depending on the problem you want to solve, whether it's a softmax function for multi-class classification or a sigmoid function for binary classification or maybe some linear regression if that's the type of problem you solve. And I want to show you this on an example based on LearNet 5. This is due to Le Can and his co-authors. It's a famous paper published in 1998, and the reason why it became so popular, it was because it was the first successful demonstration of convolutional neural networks. This was a network that was trained on pictures of handwritten digits, and its objective was to recognize the digit represented in that picture. And it has approximately 60,000 weights, and it was trained on the MNIST dataset consisting of 60,000 examples. And I want to open this up for you and discuss it layer by layer to see how this was done. And I'm showing this as a typical example of a convolutional neural networks. Nowadays, neural networks will have or may have much more layers than this one, but the architecture is the same. You have this idea of convolutional layers like we have in here, and then pooling layers, and then other convolutional layers, and then pooling layers, and then in the end you have these fully connected layers. So let's see how this works. So in this LearNet 5 we have the input in the form of pictures, and these are coming on three channels. So I'm going to show this idea that you have several channels with this depth of the picture. And here there is a picture, maybe there is this digit 3, and the size of the input, the data comes in this size, 32 by 32 by 3. And the first layer in LearNet 5 is a convolutional layer that has six filters, and it has filter size 5, and there is no padding, and the stride is 1. And so as a result, you can do these calculations based on what we discussed when we defined the convolution operator, and the result, you will see that it's this. You will have a tensor here, which is 28 by 28 by 6, and it's 6 because you have 6 filters. And so this is the first convolutional layer, and I'm going to write this conv1, convolution 1. And then the next step in this architecture, the next layer, is that we have a max pool layer. And I'm just making a comment that, in fact, in the original architecture of LearNet 5, this was in fact an average pooling. But nowadays, max pooling is much more popular and very successful. So I'm just demonstrating this with max pool, but with the observation that the original architecture was using something slightly different. And the filter size in this pooling layer is 2, and it has a stride of 2. And so the result of this, because you have this stride equal to 2, the net effect is that you reduce this by half, so you have 14 by 14 and times 6. And then the next step in this next layer in this architecture is a convolution, and we are using 16 filters, and the filter size is 5. Again, there is no padding, and the stride is 1. And so as a result, what we get is we get a tensor that's of size 10 by 10 by 16. I forgot to write here pool one, and I comment in a moment why this is a pool one, and then I denote here by conf two. The point with having here pool one is just so that I'm indicating that very often when people talk about layers, they, if there is a convolutional and a pooling layer, they actually consider them together. So very often this would be considered one single layer that consists of two different operations. One is a convolution and the other one is a pooling operator. The reason why this is considered a single layer is because the pooling layer doesn't have any weights to estimate. So the number of layers somehow, so a real layer is considered to be that which has some weights to be trained during learning. But on the other hand, people do talk separately about convolution type of layers and pooling type of layers. So there is a slight confusion here, but typically this is considered to be just one layer. So conv1 and pool1, and then we have this conv2 in here. And then this continues and it goes to a max pool, and I'm writing it here. So this again is a max pool layer, and we are using a filter size 2 and stride of 2. And the result of this is that, again, you are shrinking your input size to half, and so you would get a tensor of 5 by 5 by 16. And as a matter of fact, the next step, I don't indicate it as a layer, but there is a separate operator when you implement this in your favorite programming language. You are collapsing this tensor into a vectorial representation. So you just write these all of these entries in this tensor as a single vector. And the size of this vector is of course, I mean, 400, because that's exactly what 5 times 5 times 16 is. So there is nothing else than just collapsing this tensor into a vectorial representation. And this vector has size 400. And the next layer we have is a fully connected layer. And that fully connected layer takes as an input this vector of 400. And the layer itself is of size 120. And so this is our fully connected, and this is layer 3. And I'm indicating this as being a fully connected layer in this way. And after that, we have another fully connected layer. And this time is a fully connected layer of size 84. And it takes as an input this the activation of the previous layer of 120, and it converts it into an activation vector of 84. And then, so this is FC4, fully connected layer 4. And then finally, there is one more layer in LearNet 5, a fully connected layer FC5, that's of size 10. And obviously, it's of size 10 because this is about digit recognition. So you have 10 digits to distinguish from. And so we collapse everything to 10 values. And this again is a fully connected layer, taking the previous activation vector of a size 84 and transforming it into an activation vector of 10. And that goes into your output function, which is based on softmax. And so this is the typical architecture, and it goes like this. You have an input, and then you have a convolutional layer followed by a pooling layer. Sometimes you may have a sequence of convolutional layers and one pooling layer after that. Then you have another convolutional layer followed by a pooling layer. And then you have a number of fully connected layers that then feed to this output function that in our case is a softmax function. And it's useful to think about how the input is being transformed from layer to layer and how many parameters are involved in each layer. And so I have this summarized in a table that I want to discuss next. So I have here layer by layer, and if I take the input layer, what goes out of the input layer, what goes into the real convolutional network is going to be a data of type 32 by 32 by 3. And so in terms of how many entries you have in the output of this layer. We have 3072. And obviously there are no parameters in the input layer. There is no computation being done. It just broadcasts the inputs to the first hidden layer. Now this layer is a convolutional layer, and you have seen on the previous slide, the filter size was 5 and stride was 1 and the number of filters was 6. And so the output type you can easily calculate based on how we define the convolution operator is going to be a tensor of size 28 by 28 by 6. That gives you a data of size 4704. Now, in terms of the number of parameters you have in this layer, so for each filter, you have 6 filters. You have the content of the filter. So that filter is 5 by 5 and it has 3 channels because the data was coming in on 3 channels. And then you have also the bias. So it's 5 times 5 times 3 plus 1, and that's for each filter. So times 6, we have 456 parameters to estimate for this convolutional layer. Then we have the pooling layer. We have the filter size 2 and the stride 2, and the net effect of that is that the size is reduced to half, so it's 14 by 14. The number of channels remains obviously the same, and so the output size coming out of this layer is 1176, and obviously there are no parameters in a pooling layer. And that goes into the second convolutional layer, and this one will have an output type of 10 by 10 by 16. It's 16 because it's using 16 filters, and this 10 by 10 is easily calculated based on how the convolutional operator is defined. And so we have, in terms of the size of the output coming out of this layer, we have 1600 entries. And in terms of the number of parameters, we have 16 filters, and for each filter, we have all of these entries in the filter. So it's 5 by 5, and it works on 6 channels because that's how many channels the input had. And for each of them, we have also the bias specific to that filter. So it's 5 times 5 times 6 plus 1 times 16, and that gives us 2416 parameters. Then we have the second pooling layer. This one has a filter size of 2 and the stride is equal to 2. So the net effect is that the size is reduced by half. So we have 5 by 5. Number of channels remains the same. So that gives us an output size of 400 and obviously no parameters in a pooling layer. Now these 400, now they go into this fully connected layer that connects it to this layer of size 120. And so the output coming out of this fully connected layer is 100. It's a vector of size 120. And in terms of the number of parameters, so we have the full connections, 400 times 120. And for each neuron in this layer, we also have the bias. So that's adding one more parameter for each neuron. So the calculation of the number of parameters is 400 times 120 plus 120, and that gives us 48,120 parameters. Then we have the fully connected layer number 4. This one is a layer consisting of 84 neurons, and so the output is going to be 84. And in terms of the number of parameters, you have the full connections between the 120 in the previous layer and the 84 in the current layer, plus the bias unit for each one of these 84 neurons in the current layer. And so we get 10,164 parameters in this layer. And finally, we have the fully connected layer number 5. This one has an output of size 10. And in terms of the number of parameters, it's going to be the full connections between the 84 in the previous layer and the 10 in the current layer, plus the bias for each of the 10 neurons in the current layer. And so that gives us altogether 850 parameters. So if we are to summarize this, we get that the number of parameters to be estimated in this LeNet 5 type of architecture is 62,006, And the data that this network was trained on is the MNIST dataset, and it's exactly made of 60,000 pictures, and each one of them is of size 32 by 32 by 3 channels. A couple of comments that I still want to make. This is typical in a convolutional neural network that the size of the input goes down as you go through the convolutional layer. So the width and the height of your data goes down as you go through the convolutional layers. And the reason why they go down is essentially due to the pooling layer. You might have some shrinking also in the convolutions if you haven't padded enough, but typically the pooling layer are the ones responsible for reducing the size of the width and of the height. And the other thing that I want to comment is that typically, again, in convolutional neural networks is that as you go through the convolutional layers, the number of channels is going to go up. And that's because you are using more and more filters in the deeper layers of the neural network. In terms of the number of parameters, obviously there are much more parameters in the fully connected layers than in the convolutional layers. This is something we've discussed when we went over the rationale of the convolutional layers. There are many parameters being shared in such convolutional layers.